let's have praise you, and we thank you for your creation. We thank you for the work that you have done to make this world. We thank you for this beautiful day that you have given to us, Father. And we just thank you, Lord, that you are a mighty and that you are great. Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we thank you that because of all that he has done, that we can be a part of your family. And so, Father, we just pray that we would continue to serve and to love Jesus with everything that we have. Father, each day may we be grateful for Jesus' death, for his resurrection. And we thank you for your Holy Spirit that you have given to us, that we might live for you and that we might honor you in everything. Father, help us to continue to serve you and to love you always. And Father, we wish we could be together in church today. Father, we wish that we could be gathered in one place, but we thank you that we can gather online. And Father, we just thank you for each and every member of our church, even each and every brother and sister that we have in Christ. Father, we just pray that you would continue to bless us, that you would continue to meet all of our needs. Father, we think of those who are sick, and we just ask that you would be with them and that you would bless them. We pray that you would give them your healing. We pray for those who have financial needs or are looking for work, and we ask that you would provide for them and that you would watch over them. Father, we pray for those who may be suffering from anxiety or from depression. And Father, we pray that you would be their joy and their hope and their peace. Father, again, thank you for every blessing that we have in you. And we thank you for this great privilege of prayer that we can come to you and speak to you. And we thank you that all of those prayers are heard and that you are sufficient for every need that we have. We pray for our missionaries today. Father, we ask that you would bless them where they serve you around the world. Father, give each one wisdom, provide for each one with the needs that they have, and just give them your blessing as they serve you. May they see people come to a saving knowledge of you. And Father, we do pray for our nation today, Father. We pray that you would heal the divides, that you would heal the hurt. We pray that you would clean our nation of wickedness and of sin. We ask that you would restore the love that we should have for one another, and that we would love each other even as we have been loved by you. And so, Father, we pray that our nation would hear the good news of Jesus and submit to that truth, and that you would begin to bring healing and begin to bring restoration. We pray for our leaders. We ask that you would give them wisdom. We pray that they would fear you and honor you in everything. We pray, Father, for our troops. Watch over them. Keep them safe from the hands of the enemy. We think of all those who are on the front line with the battle against COVID-19. And we pray that you would keep each one safe, and that you would give them the strength and compassion that they need for the jobs that you have given to them. And Father, now we thank you that we can come to your word today. We just ask, Father, that you would teach us and instruct us, and give us your wisdom that we might live for you and that we might honor you in everything that we do. And we pray these things in Jesus' name, amen. Well, when I was a kid, there was a song that we used to sing in church. We still sing a lot of old songs in church, but this song isn't really one of them. I couldn't tell you the last time that I sang this song. The name of the song is "This World Is Not My Home." I'm not going to sing the song for you. You wouldn't enjoy that, but the song is somewhat energetic and upbeat for a song that really is about dissatisfaction. The first verse of the song goes like this: "This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore." And then the chorus goes, "Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore." You know, I was thinking a lot about that song this past week. I bet you can't guess why. That song reveals a conviction of the Christian faith. One conviction of the Christian faith is that our world is broken. That's why the songwriter is yearning for heaven. This world isn't his home. The songwriter knows that this world is not as it's supposed to be. Now imagine if you're spending time on a beautiful Sunday watching a video sermon, you probably have some knowledge of Christianity. But just in case you don't know much about the Christian faith, let me explain what I mean. As Christians, we believe that God created this world. The world as he made it was perfect and without fault. It was literally a paradise. God put us men and women in this paradise to rule this world with him and to worship him so as to reveal his glory. But rather than serving God and ruling under him, we try to be God and to take his glory for ourselves. We worship the things that God created, and we serve the creation rather than serving the creator. And as a result, the world is broken. Because of our rebellion against God, things in the world are not as God intended them to be. Our relationship with God is severed. Our relationship with creation is severed. Our relationship with one another is severed. This world is not the one we were created for. And so this world is full of hatred and pain and suffering. Now, many people have criticized Christians for having this view of the world. I've heard it said that Christians are too pessimistic, that they're too judgmental about the state of things in our world. But you know, the events of these past 2 weeks suggest that the Christian view of the world is a pretty accurate one. And none of us think that the events of the last 2 weeks are life as it was meant to be. I don't think any of us are satisfied with the state of our culture or our nation. We're tired of the racism. We're tired of the hatred. We're tired of the division. We're tired of the violence. We know that life is not supposed to be like this. But here's the problem. Even though we know that life is not supposed to be like this, we feel powerless to change it. If you felt hopeless at times this week, you were not the only one. I think many people looked at the events of the past 2 weeks and shook their head, not knowing how to bring about change. I mean, we don't trust the government to bring change. Violence and rioting seem to be a replication of the original problem, not a solution. A trial and a verdict only address the specific case in front of us. They don't give us a universal solution. A guilty verdict doesn't stop this from happening again. How can we make this world the place that we want it to be? Well, as a Christian, I am convinced that there is hope for change, and that hope is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, don't turn me off because I said gospel. Gospel sounds like a religious word to many. And so when I say gospel, many people want to stop listening. Many people think that religion has been a part of the problem, not the solution. But the word gospel simply means good news. In the first century, the time when Jesus lived, the term good news was used particularly for political news. And so in the first century, good news was news about a king. For the Romans, good news was news that a new king had been born, or good news was news that a new king had ascended to the throne. And when Christianity was new, Christians used the term good news just like the Romans did. When Christians preached the good news, they too were talking about a king. Only the Christian good news wasn't about Caesar. The Christian good news was about Jesus. You see, for Christians, the gospel is that Jesus is the saving king. Through his death and his resurrection, Jesus has been made King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The entirety of the world is under Jesus's reign and rule. And wherever Jesus reigns, wherever people give allegiance and obedience to their king, creation begins to be restored. Wherever Jesus truly reigns, our world begins to get fixed. The gospel proclaims that the only way to fix the problems of this broken world is to serve and to worship Jesus as King. Because Jesus is using his power to free the oppressed. He is using his power to remember the forgotten. He is using his power to humble the arrogant. He is using his power to overcome evil. The curse, the brokenness of our world begins reversing whenever Jesus is allowed to rule as King. And the only hope we have as individuals is to obey and worship Jesus as King. The only hope we have as communities is to obey and worship Jesus as King. Now, I know that many others would suggest other ways for changing our world. You know, some suggest that change is going to come in November. If only we would vote the old leaders out and we would put new leaders in, then the problems of hatred, racism, and violence will be fixed. Some think politics is the solution to our problem. Others think the key to change is awareness. We need to demonstrate, a shout about the problem so that more people know about it. If people know about it, they won't tolerate it. Education is the key to ridding people of hate and division. Other people think the solution is violence. If we beat the powerful into oblivion, If we take their goods and impoverish them, then the powerful will bow to our cause. And so some think the solution is force. But you know what? History tells us those solutions don't work too well at all. We've had tons of elections and plenty of new leaders in the past, but our problems still persist. We have more knowledge and awareness of civil rights than any people group in human history, yet individuals still suffer abuse based on their skin color. And history tells us that violence only begets more violence. Violence is a tool of destruction, not construction. The things that we have so often put our hope in are bound to fail us. There is only one hope that we have, and that hope is the gospel. The gospel of Jesus is that Jesus is King. And wherever individuals and communities submit to his rule, there will be peace and justice and reconciliation and hope. Now, this side of heaven, those things aren't absolute. They don't come completely in this world, only in the next. But we have no hope of truly knowing any of these things outside of the gospel. The only hope that we have is to accept and honor the good news that Jesus is King. But how does the good news that Jesus is King really make a difference in the world? How does the rule of Jesus really transform our planet? Now, frankly, as we said, more often religion seems to be a part of the problem, not a solution. And in light of that history, I think that people might be rightly skeptical that preaching and knowing Jesus is King will change anything. How does the gospel really change the world? Well, that's what we're going to look at this morning. If you've been with us over the last few weeks, you know that we are in the middle of a sermon series entitled The Greatest Stories Ever Told. And in this series, we are studying the parables of Jesus. Now, a parable is a short story told to make a simple point. Jesus told dozens of parables. We're only going to look at six or seven of them in the course of this series. Over the first 3 weeks, we've looked at four parables: the parable of the lost sheep, the parable of the lost coin, the parable of the lost sons, and the parable of the good Samaritan. All of those parables were in the book of Luke. Today, though, we're going to look at a parable in the book of Matthew, the first book of the New Testament. That parable is entitled The Parable of the Sower. It is found in Matthew 13. So open in your Bibles to Matthew 13 and follow as I read verses 1 through 9. Matthew 13, and I'll be reading verses 1 through 9. And Matthew writes, "That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it while all the people stood on the shore. Then he told them many things in parables, saying, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop, 160 or 30 times what was sown. Whoever has ears, let him hear." Now, Jesus tells us what in his day might have been a rather unremarkable story. If you live here in Hillsboro, you live in one of the closest things New Jersey has to a farming community. The western part of our township is dotted with farms. Still, most of us aren't that familiar with farming. It was a lot different in Jesus's day, though. Farming was the number one occupation in Jesus's day. Everybody in Jesus's day either was a farmer or they knew a farmer. So this story is based in the mundane. As a matter of fact, some people believe that Jesus told this story because he saw a farmer starting to sow as he was beginning his teaching. Some say that the beginning of this story could be translated, "Look at that farmer sowing seed." Now, it's hard to believe that Jesus would point out a farmer at work. Farmers were a dime a dozen. But Jesus used the occasion of a man farming to talk about how the kingdom of God changes the world. And Jesus' story is appropriate for this time of year. We are in planting season, or pretty close to it. And in the last months or so, many of you have gotten seed into the ground. And why have you planted that seed? Well, you have planted that seed in the hopes that in August or September or October, you will have some vegetables and fruit that you can eat and enjoy. Gardening and farming are redemptive activities. Through gardening, we hope to take barren ground and see it become fruitful and productive. And the point of gardening very often is to replace weedy ground, ground that does not produce anything useful, with ground that brings forth produce for our consumption. That's why the farmer plants in this story. He is trying to bring forth fruit that will be used to bless him and to bless others. And so the farmer will feed himself with what grows. He will feed others with what grows. The goal is to bring about change from unproductive to productive. And that is the change that we want to see in our world. You know, these past 2 weeks have made it pretty clear that our world is full of weeds and thorns that cause pain rather than blessing. Our goal is to see that weedy, thorny, painful land changed into crops. We want our world to go from cursed to blessed, from painful to productive, from divided to whole, from corrupt to just. We want to grow hope and peace where there was none before. How does that happen? How do we bring about change in such a hopeless world? Well, this parable tells us. It tells us how to go from broken to whole, from divided to peaceful, from enslaved to liberated. Our hope of change is all about the reign and the rule of Jesus. You see, this parable highlights three steps to changing our world. First, change starts with the proclamation of the good news of Jesus. Change begins in our world with the announcement that Jesus is King. Now, here in Matthew 13, we not only have Jesus' telling of the story, we also have Jesus' explanation of the story. And in his explanation of the story, Jesus reveals that his parable is an allegory. Now, many people think all of Jesus' parables are allegories. That's not true. Some of Jesus' parables are allegories, but most are not. However, this one is. In other words, every element of this parable represents something. And the key to understanding the message of the parable is to understand what each thing represents. So we might ask, what does the seed represent? What do the various types of soil represent? What does the harvest represent? Answering those questions helps us to understand Jesus' point here. And so Jesus explains the allegory to us in verses 18 through 23. Again, look back there, Matthew 13, 18 through 23. Jesus says, listen then to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears a message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. This is the seed sown along the path. The seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. The seed falling among the thorns refers to someone who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. But the seed falling on good soil refers to someone who hears the word and understands it. This is the one who produces a crop yielding 160 or 30 times what was sown. Now, Jesus tells us what the seed represents in verse 19. While Jesus isn't explicit in this verse, he makes it very clear that the seed represents the good news of the kingdom. Right in verse 19, Jesus says the birds taking seed represent Satan snatching, quote, the message of the kingdom. That's the quote from verse 19. That is what the seed represents. If you want to change a barren plot of land to a productive plot of earth, you have to plant seed. There's no other way to do it. And if we want our world to be transformed, we have to proclaim the good news about the kingdom. We have to proclaim the gospel. We have to preach to the world that Jesus is King. Individuals and communities only get transformed when Jesus is honored and obeyed as King. So what type of kingdom does Jesus rule over? Well, Matthew doesn't tell us here, but there are plenty of other places in the gospel that do. Jesus rules over a kingdom that is unlike any kingdom on this earth. You see, earthly kingdoms seek to dominate people by establishing their power. Jesus' kingdom establishes itself through humble service. Earthly kingdoms represent the interests of the rich and connected. In Jesus' kingdom, the humble and the despised come first. Political kingdoms give their countrymen pride of place. Jesus' kingdom invites anyone, no matter their nationality or tribe, to join. You see, in many ways, Jesus' kingdom is an upside-down kingdom. Jesus' kingdom is run precisely the opposite way that political kingdoms are run. In Luke chapter 4, Jesus is in his home synagogue. In Luke 4, Jesus is reading and teaching on the Sabbath day in the town where he grew up. And here Jesus announces himself as king. He does this by reading a passage from the Old Testament prophet Isaiah. Isaiah had written about the Messiah, the king that was to come. And in Luke 4, 18 through 19, Jesus reads, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." What is the purpose of Jesus' kingship? It's not to serve the rich and powerful. It's not to curry their favor and support. Instead, Jesus wants to preach good news to the poor. He wants to free those unjustly imprisoned. He wants to heal the blind. He wants to liberate the suffering. He wants to declare the year of the Lord's favor, the time when debts were canceled and when property was returned to those who had been exploited. Where the good news of Jesus is announced, life does not remain the same. Creation is restored. The curse is lifted. And to start to change the world, we have to proclaim the message that Jesus is king. This is part of the good news that we often overlook. You know, to us, the good news, the gospel, is often just about personal salvation. To us, often the gospel is simply a formula about getting to heaven. And so when we preach the gospel, we typically talk about the way that our sins are forgiven so that we can be made right with God and we can go to heaven when we die. To us, the gospel is simply Jesus paying the price for our sin on the cross. Now, all that we teach about the gospel is true. Jesus indeed did die for our sins on the cross. If we give Jesus our allegiance, he will grant us life in God's eternal kingdom when it comes. But the gospel is not just an announcement about sin and forgiveness. It is also an announcement that Jesus is now reigning over the world. And the announcement is an invitation to come and be a part of Jesus' kingdom. This isn't a political kingdom. It's not trying to subvert or overthrow governments. It isn't interested in political power. Jesus' kingdom isn't interested in finding a place on a map to call its own. Jesus' kingdom is all about extending Jesus' rule through the lives of women and men who will serve him. The Apostle Peter, one of Jesus' disciples, he highlighted this aspect of the gospel in Acts chapter 2 when he preached a sermon on the day of Pentecost. In Acts 2, the Holy Spirit has come upon Christians for the first time. And the presence of the Holy Spirit caused those Christians to speak in foreign languages that were previously unknown to them. And so this sudden fluency in these foreign languages draws a crowd of foreigners who are in Jerusalem to worship God. And so Peter preaches a sermon about the good news of Jesus when all these people gather. And how does Peter describe the good news in this first ever sermon in the history of the church? Well, he says this. He says, "Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah." That's actually the final line of Peter's sermon. That's the crescendo of his gospel presentation. Peter preached the whole sermon just to get to this announcement. And when he made the announcement, the sermon was done. The announcement was the point of the sermon. And what was the announcement? The announcement was Jesus is King. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Messiah. That's the announcement that starts to change the world. So first Jesus teaches, or first Jesus tells us that our world begins to change as he is announced as King. Second, our world begins to change as the message of the gospel takes root in our hearts. The world begins to change as the message of the gospel takes root in our hearts. You know, Jesus outlines four different responses to the gospel message here in Matthew 13. We said that Jesus gives an explanation of the parable in verses 18 through 23. And in those verses, Jesus tells us that the four types of soil in his story about the farmer represent four different responses to the gospel announcement. Now, from those responses, it is clear that many people reject the message that Jesus is king. You know, some people find that the message of Jesus as king makes no sense, and thus they reject it out of hand. That's what the seed along the trodden down path represents. Jesus says that the birds snatching it are symbolic of Satan snatching the truth away when people don't understand it. Others understand the truth of the gospel, but they don't live it out. The rocky ground is symbolic of people who embrace the news that Jesus is king, but then abandon that truth once that news causes them difficulty or suffering. The thorny ground is symbolic of people who embrace the news that Jesus is king. They even live out that news for a time. But then the desires of this life, the thirst for money, sex, or power, cause them to abandon their allegiance to Jesus and to stop serving his cause. And so for many, Jesus says the message of the gospel of Jesus as King is not transformative. It does not change who they are or how they live in this world. But there is a fourth soil. This is the soil where the seed is able to grow. And the fourth soil represents people who hear the good news that Jesus is King. They hear the good news that Jesus is bringing a new kingdom, and they embrace that truth and they let it transform their lives. These people give their allegiance to Jesus and to the new type of kingdom that he is bringing. They accept the forgiveness of sin that Jesus offers. They are made alive through the renewing power of the Holy Spirit. They give themselves to suffering as Jesus suffered, knowing that suffering is transformative and redemptive. And from their life flows a bountiful crop of blessing after blessing that glorifies God and that meets the needs of other people. Serving Jesus as King, these people produce fruit that changes the world and that begins to restore creation one person and one soul at a time. Now, I think Jesus's point with the four soils is obvious, right? While the announcement that Jesus is King is good news, that announcement is only powerful and transformative when we allow that announcement to shape our hearts and to shape our lives. See, Jesus's parable invites us to examine ourselves. Jesus invites us to examine our response to the good news that Jesus is the saving King. He wants us to ask, have we understood that news and given allegiance to Jesus's kingdom? You see, the world changes when people commit their allegiance and obedience to Jesus as King. You see, in verse 19, Jesus equates the different soils to possible states of our hearts. Right? In verse 19, Jesus says that the sowing of the gospel seeds take place in the fields that represent our hearts. Now, biblically speaking, our hearts are our control centers. In the Bible, our hearts is used as a symbol for the place of our emotions and intellect and will. All of those things, emotions, intellect, will, are represented by our heart. And the world begins to change when we allow our emotions and intellect and will to be shaped by the announcement that Jesus is King. When we pledge our loyalty and allegiance to the values of Jesus and his kingdom, then we begin to move our world in a different direction. You know, in verse 23, Jesus speaks of the one who hears the word of the gospel and who understands it. When Jesus speaks of understanding there, he's referring to what we might call practical application. Understanding is not just about grasping the message intellectually. Understanding here is about living the message out. And so the one who takes the message and applies it in their life, who lives it out, is the one who begins to bring growth to an unproductive ground. The one who takes the message and lives it out, not being distracted by persecution or by the worries of life, they are the one who begins to bring God's blessing into the world. They begin to reverse the curse and to bring a life-giving harvest instead of thorns. You see, for the world to change, we need to honor Jesus as King. There needs to be a proper response to the gospel message. And so changing the world starts with changing our hearts. It starts with changing our response to Jesus. You know, it's interesting. Most people want to blame everybody else for the world's problems. You know, we want to think our world would be a better place if only that political party behaved better. We want to think our world would be a better place if only that nationality behaved better. We want to think our world would be a better place if only that religious group behaved better. We always want to think that our world would be a better place, that the problems of our world would go away if only other people changed. But Jesus's parable suggests that it's not others who need to change, it is us. They might need to change, but we need to change too, and we need to change first. We need to examine our hearts to see if we are committed to honoring and obeying Jesus as King. This week on Facebook, I came across a quote by the famous Russian author Alexander Solzhenitsyn. Solzhenitsyn wrote this. He said, "Gradually it was disclosed to me that the line separating good and evil passes not through states, nor between classes, nor between political parties either, but the line separating good from evil passes right through every human heart." You see, we want to blame nations for the evil in our world. We want to blame groups of people and political parties for our suffering. But the same evil that marks our society marks our own hearts outside of Jesus. The world can only begin to change as we allow the gospel to lead us to the forgiveness of sins, which allows us to serve Jesus as King and Lord. And so first, Jesus teaches that our world begins to change as he is announced as King. Second, our world begins to change as the message takes root in people's hearts. And finally, our world begins to change as embracing the good news produces fruit in our lives. It begins to change as embracing the good news produces fruit in our lives. Now, when you first consider Jesus's parable, it doesn't seem like there's much hope for change in this world. After all, consider where the message of the gospel grows. According to the parable, the gospel doesn't grow in too many places. Only one out of the four plots of ground allow growth that leads to harvest and to fruit. That's a 25% success rate. That doesn't sound too high. Assuming that the four soils take up the same amount of space, then the seed fails 75% of the time. That does not sound like a strategy for successful farming. That doesn't sound like a strategy for changing the world. You know, in most schools, a 25 is an F. A 25 is failure. How can we change the world if so few people follow Jesus? How can we change the world if so few hearts apply the message that Jesus is King? Well, you know what? It's true the gospel doesn't grow in too many places. That's the bad news. But here's the good news. When the gospel grows, it has tremendous impact. Look at what Jesus says about the harvest that is had from the good soil in verse 8. Look at Matthew 13, 8. That verse says, still other seed fell on good soil where it produced a crop, 160 or 30 times what was sown. Jesus says the farmer gets from 30 to 100 times more than the seed he has sown. Now, in Jesus's day, most farmers would have been giddy about a 10% return. In Jesus's day, if you got back two times as much, even that would have been a solid year. Most of the time in Jesus's day, breaking even wasn't a bad thing. But Jesus says this farmer gets a harvest from the good soil that is 30, 60, or even 100 times what he sowed. That is a bumper crop. And Jesus is saying, if you will serve him as King, if you will pledge your allegiance to him, if you will serve in his power and let him shape you to live out his values, your life will have an impact beyond what you can ever imagine. Now, if you are committed to Jesus's kingdom, your life might impact 30 people. It might impact 60 people. It will impact 100 people. When we commit ourselves to serve Jesus as King, our lives will take an oversized influence. We will have an impact beyond what should be possible. A person sold out to the Lordship of Jesus will change this world in almost immeasurable ways. Now, you may not always see that change. Sometimes the seed that you sow or produce may not grow until you've been taken into glory. But a life that honors Jesus as King is a life whose influence for blessing and healing is magnified throughout the world. Jesus tells another parable about this later in Matthew 13. Look down at verse 33. Matthew 13, 33, Jesus tells this parable. He told them still another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed into about 60 pounds of flour until it worked all through the dough. You know, 60 pounds, that is a lot of flour. We have a 25-pound bag of flour in our pantry, and that thing is monstrous. You know, I think a 60-pound bag of flour might be taller than me. That would be a lot of flour. Yet one tiny bit of yeast can change that whole huge bag of flour. It can cause that whole huge bag of flour to expand, rise, and come alive. And Jesus is saying that is how the kingdom of God works. One little person committed to Jesus can have an outsized influence. If you will confess Jesus as King, and if you will pledge your allegiance to him, Jesus will use you to make a huge difference in our world. If you honor and obey Jesus as King, you will bring reconciliation. You will bring hope. You will bring justice. 75% of the world may say no to Jesus, but your 25% will be more influential and more powerful than that 75%. When you are committed to Jesus as King, Jesus will make your life productive and fruitful. Your life will bring hope and healing and reconciliation. You know, my heart is broken by what happened to George Floyd in Minneapolis. And my heart is broken by the aftermath of his death, where cities were looted and burned. Racism, violence, hatred, they all give testimony to the fact that our world is not as it was meant to be. We have rebelled against God, and that has led to the brokenness of our world. But the good news is that our world will not be forever broken. Through his faithfulness to God and through his willingness to take on our suffering, Jesus has been revealed to be king. He has ascended into heaven, sitting at the right hand of God, ruling over this world. Now, right now, submission to his rule is voluntary. There are large groups of people who still refuse to pledge allegiance to our king. But one day, Jesus is going to enforce his rule. One day, Jesus is going to return to earth from heaven. And at that time, every tongue will confess, every knee will bow that Jesus Christ is Lord. But right now, service to Jesus is voluntary. No one is forced to recognize Jesus as king. But when people do recognize Jesus as king, when people do believe the message and apply it to their lives, then God gives those people an outsized influence to bring hope and healing and peace into this broken world. Now, if you're listening to this and you're not a Christian, I have to be honest this morning. I have to say that too many Christians have tried to serve the wrong type of kingdom. We've seen that especially here in America. Too many Christians in America have failed to understand that God's kingdom is an upside-down kingdom. And so many in the church have tried to establish power. They've tried to pursue wealth. They've tried to exclude the lower classes and the unwashed masses from the church building. Many Christians have demonstrated the values of the culture rather than the values of the king. And if you're outside of the church, we have to apologize to you. I can see why you would want to doubt this message. Too often, we in the church have lived like we are in the kingdom of the world rather than the kingdom of Jesus. And we confess that disobedience this morning. But we in the church also confess Jesus. This is the Jesus who said, "Blessed are the poor. Blessed are those who hunger now. Blessed are those who weep now. Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you and insult you." There's no blessing in poverty. It's not fun to lack resources. There's no blessing in hunger. You can't live if you can't fill your stomach. But the blessing is that God is concerned about the poor. He is concerned about the hungry. When God rules, he rules for the sake of the forgotten and the despised. And I've seen Christians live that truth out. History is full of examples of Christians who brought hope, healing, peace, and reconciliation as they served Jesus as king and as they represented his values. I like the way the famous author Leslie Newbegin put it. Newbegin wrote, "It is not the primary business of the church to advocate for a new social order. It is the primary business of the church to be a new social order." We are to embody God's kingdom. We are to surrender to Jesus as king and to learn to walk in his ways so that he can build his kingdom in us. Change will happen when Jesus is proclaimed as king. Change will happen when Jesus is confessed as king. Change will happen when Jesus is obeyed as king. If you want to change your world, hear and receive the good news that Jesus is king, then live your life for the kingdom of Jesus. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the good news that Jesus is king. Father, we thank you that he rules over all this world. And we thank you that the day is coming when Jesus will return and he will right every wrong, when he will heal the wounded, and when he will give consolation to the brokenhearted. And Father, you ask us even now to honor Jesus as king and to begin to bring that kingdom into the world. And so we pray, Father, that Jesus would form his kingdom in us. We pray that we would yield to this message, that we would give Jesus our allegiance and our obedience. And we pray, Father, that each and every day we would live according to the values of the kingdom of God and not the values of the kingdom of this world. And so teach us about Jesus, help us to embrace the suffering that he embraced. And Father, even as Jesus saw his suffering lead to life, may we be willing to suffer that others might find the life in Jesus through the testimony that we give. And we pray these things in Jesus' name, amen. Right now, we're gonna have a little musical worship interlude before communion. This will give you a chance to gather your bread and your a juice or wine if you've not done so already. Then we're going to have a worship song, and then we'll come back to celebrate communion together.
kneel down on the shore, be thirsty no more, go under and be purified, follow Christ to the holy mountain, sinner sorry and wrecked by the fall, cleanse your heart and your soul in the fountain that flows for you and for me and for all. At the wonderful, tragic, mysterious tree, on that beautiful, scandalous night, you and me were atoned by his blood, forever washed white, on that beautiful, scandalous night. On the hillside you will be delivered, at the foot of the cross justified, in your spirit restored by the river that pours from our blessed Savior's side. At the wonderful, tragic, mysterious tree, on that beautiful, scandalous night, you and me were atoned by his blood, forever washed white, on that beautiful, scandalous night.
I'm glad that we're able to celebrate communion this morning. We have not celebrated a communion as a church since March 8th. It has been almost 3 months. It is hard to believe that we as a church have gone 3 months without meeting, let alone celebrating communion. But I am glad that we have the opportunity to celebrate online today. You know, communion is a gift to his church from Jesus. Jesus instituted communion that we might be careful never to forget him. Now, we spent 3 months away from gathering together as a church. And when we are not together, it's easy to forget that our primary allegiance is to Christ. And we need reminders that Jesus is King. We need reminders that Jesus died, creating a new people for himself. And communion is the reminder that Jesus gave us. Jesus instituted communion that we might not forget him. Paul explains the meaning of communion in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Now, the church in Corinth, if you've been with us on Wednesday nights, you know it was a very troubled church. There was a lot of division and sin that plagued that church. There were problems with how the church conducted itself when it gathered together for worship. And part of the trouble was found in the church's celebration of communion. The Corinthian church was celebrating communion in a way that emphasized the division between rich and poor in their congregation. And so the Corinthian celebration of communion was not exactly the demonstration of Christ's kingdom that we talked about in our sermon. And so when Paul wrote 1 Corinthians, Paul gave instructions to the Corinthians about how they were to celebrate communion properly. As I read those instructions, listen for the word remembrance, because the purpose of communion is to help us remember the atoning sacrifice of our King Jesus. 1 Corinthians 11, 17 through 32 says this. It says, "In the following directives, I have no praise for you, for your meetings do more harm than good. In the first place, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you, and to some extent, I believe it. No doubt there have to be differences among you to show which of you have God's approval. So then, when you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper you eat, for when you are eating, some of you go ahead with your own private suppers. As a result, one person remains hungry and another gets drunk. Don't you have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God by humiliating those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you? Certainly not in this matter. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So then, whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves. That is why many of you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. But if we were more discerning with regard to ourselves, we would not come under such judgment. Nevertheless, when we are judged in this way by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be finally condemned with the world." What did Jesus say about this gift of communion? He said to do this in remembrance of me. And as we celebrate communion, we remember thankfully how Jesus achieved our salvation through his atoning sacrifice. We also remember how Jesus became king through his humble obedience and suffering. Now, let me be clear. Partaking in communion doesn't save us. Jesus alone is the one who makes us right with God. The bread and the juice or wine are only symbols of what Jesus has done for us. The bread and the juice don't grant us forgiveness. Salvation comes when we pledge faith and allegiance to our saving King, repenting of our sin and trusting in him as Lord. And so if you are a Christian, we invite you to joyfully participate in communion at this time. And if you are not a Christian, we invite you to submit to Jesus as King, to find the forgiveness of sins through the cross that he can only offer. Now, let me say just one last thing before we celebrate communion here. I deliberated a long time before deciding whether or not we would celebrate communion online. You see, Paul was concerned that some people were being excluded from the Corinthian celebration of communion. He did not want communion when anyone was left out. And I have to be honest, I was concerned that an online celebration of communion might leave some people out, especially people not comfortable with technology or not able to afford technology. That's one of the reasons that I delayed communion a few months. But in the last few months, I've seen almost everyone in our church participate in a Zoom meeting. I've heard from almost everyone in the church by email. I've been told by almost everyone in the church that they were able to watch the sermons on video. And so I did come to feel that everyone in the church could participate in this time should they choose. But I want you to know that if someone was excluded, that was not my intention. And if you know someone who could not celebrate with us, I want you to know that I will be happy to bring a socially distanced communion to them. And so please let me know, because we do not want anyone left out. With that said, let's give thanks for the bread. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the sacrifice that Jesus made on our behalf. We thank you that he was willing to suffer death that we might be forgiven and that we might escape the penalty and the punishment of our sin. Father, now we just thank you for the bread that you have provided for us. May we remember all that Jesus has done, and we pray in his name, amen. And so Jesus said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's now give thanks for the cup and for the shed blood of our Lord. Father, we thank you that you were willing to take suffering and punishment that we didn't, that what you did not deserve, but that we did. And Father, there was no reason for Jesus to be on that cross. We know that he had never sinned, that he had never committed a wrong. And yet Jesus came into this world, he humbled himself, he lived among us. He went and bore that horrific penalty on our behalf. Father, there are never enough words that we can say to thank Jesus for the sacrifice he made for us. We just pray that our lives too would be a sacrifice and that we would live and honor Jesus by living the way that he did and by embracing suffering even as he did. And we pray this in Jesus' name, amen. And Jesus said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me."